May the Lord bless you from Zion, and may you see the prosperity of Jerusalem all the days of your life, always, now, and ever, and forever.
Thank you.
forsake this offering the Catholic for their salvation, let us pray for the Lord.
Wisdom be authentic. Resurrection. We bow to your cross, O Lord.
Let us be attentive.
Peace be to all.
Wisdom be attentive. Time when the chief priest and the temple guard saw Jesus with Pilate, They shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said, "Take him and crucify him yourself. I find no case against him." The Jews responded, "We have our law, and according to that law he must die because he made himself God's son." When Pilate heard this kind of talk, he was more afraid than ever. Going back into Praetorium, he said to Jesus, "Where do you come from?" Jesus would not give him any answer. "Do you refuse to speak to me?" Then Pilate asked him, "Do you not know that I have the power to release you and the power to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no power over me, whatever, unless it were given you from above." Pilate heard the people shouting, so he brought Jesus outside and took a seat on the judge's bench at the place called the Stone Pavement, Gabbatha in Hebrew. It was the preparation day for Passover, and the hour was about noon. Pilate said to the Jews, "Look at your king." And they shouted, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" "What?" Pilate exclaimed, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests replied, "We have no king but Caesar." In the end, Pilate handed Jesus over to be crucified. Jesus was led away and, carrying the cross by himself, went out to what is called the place of the skull, in Hebrew Golgotha. They crucified him and two others with him, one on either side, Jesus in the middle. Pilate had an inscription placed on the cross, which read, "Jesus the Nazarene, the King of the Jews." This inscription in Hebrew, Latin, and Greek was read by many of the Jews, since the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city. The chief priests and the Jews tried to tell Pilate, "You should not have written, 'The King of the Jews.' Write instead, 'This man came to be King of the Jews.'" Near the cross of Jesus there stood his mother's sister, Mary the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. Seeing his mother there with the disciple whom he loved, Jesus said to his mother, "Woman, there is your son." In turn he said to the disciple, "There is your mother." From that hour onward the disciple took her into his care. Then Jesus bowed his head and delivered over his spirit. Since it was the preparation day, the Jews did not want to have the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, for that Sabbath was a solemn feast day. They asked Pilate that the legs be broken and the bodies be taken away. Accordingly, the soldiers came and broke the legs of the men crucified with Jesus, first of the one, then of the other. When they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. One of the soldiers thrust a lance into his side, and immediately blood and water flowed out. This testimony has been given by an eyewitness, and his testimony is true. He tells what he knows is true, so that you may believe.
Christ is moment.
morning we will be ordaining Deacon Artur to the priesthood. So I would like to talk this morning about the priestly vocation and any religious vocation, especially what the Holy Scriptures have to say about these vocations. I would like to point out some of the common elements that the Old Testament and the New Testament say constitute these vocations. Religious vocations in the Bible begin with Abraham and chronologically end with the deacons in the Acts of the Apostles. Those called are the kings, the prophets, the apostles, the deacons, and others with a particular mission, such as, for example, Moses and St. John the Baptist. These biblical vocations exhibit a number of common elements which can be traced throughout the Old and the New Testaments, and there are especially three elements that are most common to all religious vocations. It's not surprising to learn that the element which appears most frequently in Scripture is the assurance of divine protection and assistance, which absolutely guarantees the success of a vocation. We can see this right from the beginning with Abraham. The Lord said to Abraham, I will bless you. I will make your name great so that you will be a blessing for others. In other words, God is going to do everything. It's as if he was telling Abraham, you do your best, I'll do the rest. St. Paul, when he speaks of his ministry in Troas, says, when I came to Troas to preach the gospel, the door of opportunity was opened for me by the Lord. It was the Lord himself who opened up all kinds of opportunities so that St. Paul's mission would be successful. It was God who was accomplishing all through St. Paul. We can say that St. Paul was used like an instrument in God's hands to accomplish what God wanted him to do. This assurance of assistance becomes doubly emphatic if a person feels that he is really not equal to the task that God is giving him to do. Moses didn't want to lead the chosen people out of Egypt into the promised land. He objected. He said, I'm not an eloquent speaker. I'm slow of speech. What does God tell him? It is I who will assist you and teach you what you are to say. The prophet Jeremiah tried desperately to get out of his vocation. He told the Lord, I do not know how to speak. And anyway, I'm too young for all of this. The Lord merely comforts him and says, have no fear because I am with you. St. Paul sums up this divine assistance when he wrote this. God chose those whom the world considers absurd to shame the wise. He singled out the weak to shame the strong. He chose the world's low-born and despised, those who count for nothing, to reduce to nothing those who consider themselves something. It is no less true now than it was in biblical times that God assures the success of a priestly vocation, any kind of religious vocation. Now, the seminary faculty and lead bishops must constantly make judgments about those who wish to be ordained, especially to the priesthood. We always have to remind ourselves that it's God Himself who assures the success of a vocation. We are reminded always of the life of St. John Vianney, who by any human standards was really not fit to be ordained a priest. He was not a very intelligent man at all. The seminary staff had a difficult problem with him. Oh, he was a very holy man, but he was not intelligent. He was not up to the standards they considered normal for the priesthood. But their problem was, he was such a good young man, so holy, so prayerful. So they finally decided on a plan, which was to recommend to the bishop that he be ordained to the priesthood, but send him to a small farming village where the people aren't well educated anyway. They wouldn't be able to understand any kind of theological sermons that John Vianney would tell them. They would just be happy with him celebrating the Mass, giving them the sacraments they required, burying their dead, baptizing their babies. So the bishop followed this advice. He ordained John Vianney and sent him to a small farming town of Ars in France. Now there were only 300 people there in that town, many of whom were not very religious at all. They were very spiritual. So St. John then did what he thought was best. But he could do the best. And that was to pray. So he constantly prayed and fasted for his people. And over the years, slowly but surely, they began to go to church more frequently and become more deeply spiritual. And finally, his fame spread throughout the whole region. But a holy priest he was. And finally, thousands upon thousands of people started coming to church to go to confession to this holy priest. And in the end, of course, after he died, he was canonized as saint. And the church made him and proclaimed him the patron saint of priests. Now, St. John Vianney had a classmate in the seminary was very brilliant. There was no question among faculty members to ordain him to a priesthood. And indeed, the bishop ordained him. He eventually became the Cardinal Archbishop of Marseille in France. Today, everybody knows about the curé of Ars, St. John Vianney, the saint, the patron saint of priests. Nobody remembers the name of that brilliant scholar who became the Cardinal Archbishop of Marseille, who was not canonized. So it's true then, what St. Paul wrote, that God sometimes picks the low-born, the weak, to do his work. But I'm also reminded of the use of divine help to make up for our human deficiencies is only fruitful when a priest dedicates his priestly life to prayer and fasting, especially in the celebration of the divine liturgy. St. St. John Vianney was convinced that the fervor of a priest's life really depends entirely on the fervor of his celebration of the liturgy. He wrote this: "The reason why a priest is lax is that he does not pay attention to the Mass. My God, how we ought to pity the priest who celebrates as if he were engaged in something routine." St. John Vianney tells the priest that you have to pray in order to have a successful priesthood. Now, another element which sacred scripture indicates is common to a religious vocation is that a person will experience hardships, difficulties, and even persecutions. Scripture never tries to cover up this aspect of the priesthood. That is the very center of the priesthood in the New Testament. After all, Christ, the high priest, suffered, died, and was buried. And we priests are meant to emulate him in our own personal lives. Christ did not seek self-glory. He sought self-sacrifice. That's what priests have to do. At the Last Supper, our Lord reminds the apostles that if they persecuted me, they're going to persecute you as well. Deacon Arthur knows this very well. In his youth, he was brought up under the communists in the Ukraine to experience somewhat this persecution of the church in his younger years. But in spite of these difficulties, Christ always reminds the apostles they have nothing to fear. They're in the hands of God, and not even death will defeat their will. And the verification of this promise can be found in the lives of our Byzantine Catholic bishops in Ukraine and Slovakia in the 20th century. Blessed Theodore Ramosha, the Bishop of Ushgorod in Ukraine. Blessed Peter Bogdanovich, Blessed Basil Hopko, the bishops in Slovakia. The communists in the 20th century tried to destroy our Byzantine Catholic Church. They didn't succeed because we were in the hands of God. And today our churches there are thriving. The third and final element, which seems to be especially common to a religious vocation, is the concept of renunciation. Gospels are explicit when they speak of the demands which Christ makes upon his disciples. This renunciation, he tells them, is going to be hatred to them. He says, if you belong to this world, it will love you as its own. The reason it hates you is that you have renounced the world. And Christ was particularly insistent on the renunciation of personal wealth. We recall the story in St. Matthew's Gospel, as well as St. Mark's Gospel, about a very rich young man comes up to Jesus and says he wants to grow in spiritual perfection. He asks our Lord, what should I do in order to grow in this perfection? Christ starts to enumerate some of the commandments. The young man says to him, well, I kept all of these since I was a child. And St. Mark, in his gospel, tells us that Jesus was so impressed with this young man that, as St. Mark tells us, he looked upon him with love and decided to make him one of his disciples. So he tells the young man, so all that you have, give it to the poor, and then come and follow me. The lad explicitly requested by the Lord for this young man to renounce his wealth and take up a religious vocation. Absolutely discouraged the man from pursuing that vocation any further. We are told that he simply walks away sad. So we can see that from all that I have said, the biblical concept of a religious vocation requires a great deal of maturity and self-discipline. These are required because the biblical concept demands a total commitment without any kind of reservations. Even those reservations that might be included in a normal lifestyle. But the priesthood is not a normal lifestyle. To stand in the footsteps of Jesus, to represent Jesus to your people, is not a normal lifestyle. This requires an extraordinary commitment, which is not normal to most people. And so this is the commitment, then, that Deacon Arthur is making this morning, as he accepts the ordination to the priesthood. So let us all keep him in our prayers. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Your presence, your great
Fitzgerald.
Always now and ever and forever.
May the Lord God remember his kingdom, our Holy Father Francis, Pope of Rome, our most reverend Metropolitan William, our Galilean bishops, the entire priestly, diaconal, monastic order, our government, and all the service of our country, the ever memorable founders and benefactors of this holy church, may the Lord God remember all of you Christians of the true faith, always, now, and ever, and forever.
Pray for him, most reverend bishop.
May the Lord bless him from Zion and may he see the prosperity of Jerusalem on the day of his life.
Pray for him, most reverend bishop.
May the Holy Spirit come upon him and the power of the Most High overshadow him.
Gracias. always heals what is infirm, supplies what is lacking, ordains the pious deacon Artur to be a presbyter. Therefore, let us pray for him that the grace of the All-Holy Spirit may come upon him. And let us all say,
Lord, have mercy, Lord, have mercy.
Servant pleasing you in every way. Grant that he may live worthily in this honored presbyterate, giving to him by your foreknowing power, for yours is the kingdom and the power and the glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Amen.
In peace, let us pray to the Lord. To the Lord. Protection, perseverance, peace, health, salvation, and the works of his hands, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For the priest Artur, now ordained, and for his salvation, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
For God, we grant him a pure and blameless priesthood, let us pray to the Lord.
Lord, have mercy.
And preserve us, O God, by your grace.
Lord, have mercy.
O God, you are great in power and unsearchable in knowledge, wondrous in your counsels, beyond the children of men. O Lord, fill with the gifts of the Holy Spirit this your servant. You have been pleased to raise the order of presbyter. That he may be worthy to stand blamelessly before your holy altar, proclaim the gospel of your kingdom, to sanctify the word of your truth, to offer you gifts and spiritual sacrifices, and to renew your people by the bath of rebirth. In your great goodness, grant that he may receive the reward of good stewardship in his order, when he will meet the second coming of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son. For blessed and glorified is your most honored and magnificent name, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and ever and forever.
Amen.
Thank you.
Axios.
Axios, Axios, Axios. Creator.
is proper in just to seek to bless you, to praise you, to thank you, to worship you in every place of your dominion. For you are God, ineffable, inconceivable, invisible, incomprehensible, ever existing and ever the same. You and your only begotten Son and your only Spirit. Your Father, Son, and God exists in the beginning and raises up to the abode. Left nothing undone as your Father said, and gave us your kingdom to God. For all this we thank you, your only begotten Son and your Holy Spirit, for all that we know and that we do not know, for the manifest benefits bestowed on us. We also thank you for this liturgy which you are pleased to accept from our hands, even though they stand before you thousands of archangels, tens of thousands of angels, cherubim and seraphim, six winged, many eyes soaring aloft on their wings, singing, shouting, crying aloud, and saying the triumphal hymn.
Precious blood of your Christ, changing them by your Holy Spirit.
receive this pledge and keep it whole and protected to your last breath. You will give an accord for it at the second fearful coming of our great God and Savior, Jesus Christ. And for those who partake of that, they bring about the spirit of vigilance, the remission of sins, the communion of the Holy Spirit, the fullness of the heavenly kingdom, and confidence in you, not judgment or condemnation. Moreover, we offer you this spiritual sacrifice, love is a part of the faith, from all the scholars, faith, God's prophets, pastors, teachers, evangelists, martyrs, and saints, and the spirit of all the creation, especially the people. I also believe in our spirit, our blessed Lord, and the end of us, and the
Lord.
Grant this, O Lord.
Christian,
the part of transgressions, the communion of the Holy Spirit, the inheritance of the kingdom of heaven, confidence in that judgment of God of nation, and make us worthy, O Master, that we may with confidence, without condemnation, dear call you Father, God of heaven, and say,
Our Father, who art in heaven,
Remember me, O Master, when you come into your kingdom. Remember me, O Holy One. forever saved, the divine, holy, most pure, immortal, heavenly, life-creating, and awesome mysteries of Christ, let us worthily thank the Lord.
Yeah. the beacon, my home.
Blessed are all who fear the Lord, who walk in His ways. You are the kings of your hands, Savior. Blessed are you, and it shall be well with you. Your life shall be like a fruitful vine in the recesses of your house.
Thank you.